So, as you may have said, I'm a professor with Democritus University of Thrace, but I run all my projects in, with IDI. And today I will give a talk on a project that we work together with Maria. This project has to do with autonomous square, autonomous underwater vehicles, and where Maria applied and developed her concept on seeing through murky water. Stefan's already talked about it. So the presentation is kind of two different presentations. The first part is written by me. The second part was written by Maria's students in this project, Akis Tsiortsios from Imperial College. And please note that I'm not an image processing person, so this part I can probably not be able to answer all of the questions. So, anyway, when it comes to the underwater world, there has been a lot of interest, especially in the recent years, in the underwater world. Is probably one of the few areas in our Earth that is not that explored. It's not that exploited. So there are a lot of interest to work towards new technologies for underwater missions in many different things, environmental monitoring, or there is, I mean, the accident in the Gulf of Mexico with the oil spills is one of the most prominent examples. Underwater mining, underwater archaeology, mariculture, many other different many different applications. And of course, that's why that is one of the reasons for the Blue Growth Program in Horizon, where the European Commission tries to, I mean, gives a lot of money to for underwater for exploring the underwater world. So now, currently, most of the missions are taking care. I mean, when we try to explore an area, an underwater area, or to find, I mean, for instance, we are looking for a barrel that has, or for a container that has been sealed from a ship or something like that. Usually, we have either divers that do the work, or static sensors. So we deploy static sensors, and they do the work. There are a lot of disadvantages for doing so. First of all, it's cumbersome. Usually, I mean, to deploy static sensors or even divers is difficult to deploy. There is a lot of work to do so, and of course, in cases of deep waters or in cases where something is dangerous there, or for instance, if you have a chemical or something like that, it's not feasible at all to deploy one of those divers or static sensors. When I'm talking about static sensors, I mean sensors that are located on fixed location. That's why there is a lot of research on an area in robotics of autonomous underwater vehicles and related technologies. For instance, you can have an autonomous surface vehicle, a boat that is moving autonomously, or you can have an ROV that is again something that is an underwater vehicle, but you have a cable so you can operate it. But anyways, when I'm using the term AUVs, I'm talking about all of those. So, AUVs is a technology that is becoming mature now. I mean, we have right now, you can go and buy a small AUV for 5 or 10,000 euros. The technologies that are plugged into the AUVs are also, I mean, we have an evolution there. The underwater communications are becoming way, way faster than more reliable. The same for the localization system, the sensors, and so on. However, I mean, when you deploy something under the water, you have to deal with very severe sensing, communication, localization limitations. You don't see well, you don't hear well, of course, because it's water, and of course, localization is a big issue because you don't have GPS fixes. That's why, again, most of the existing technologies, either on research programs or in commercial programs, they rely on predefined trajectories. So what you do, I mean, you search for a barrel or you search for an underwater archaeological location. What you do is that you go there, you predefine a trajectory for the AUV, you deploy the AUV, then you come back, if you are satisfied with the results, you're okay, usually you're not, then you, again, you define a new trajectory, and so on. So this is problematic for two different main reasons. First of all, it's not possible to, it's not useful to deploy many AUVs because, there is no cooperation between the AUVs. So there's no, if you want to deploy two or three AUVs, you just divide the area where you want to deploy them, and then you have each of them being responsible for one of the areas. And of course, most importantly, you cannot monitor dynamic events. So if something is moving, if you have a noise spill that is moving, or something like that. So the usual practices like this, I already talked about it. So you have, underwater, you design a trajectory, you have the AUV move through this predefined trajectory, and this is from a real experiment here. This is the actual surface. We have, we have a very good map of this area. You can see that, that there are a lot of heights and ups and downs. And this is the predefined trajectory. I'm not sure if you can see very well the picture. But anyways, if you look, if you compare this picture with this one, you can see that the AUV have missed a lot of information. So you have to do it again and again. That was the idea of Nautilus, the project. This was a project that we wrote together with Maria, I was the coordinator. Maria, she came as a part of Imperial College because she was 25% in Imperial, and she was responsible for the vision system and, of course, and trying to fuse vision and so on signals, maps, but that was not an easy work, and probably it's not feasible at least within this project. So, the Nautilus approach has to do with two things. First of all, is to develop better sensing, communication, and localization technology. So, to develop some new sensors, or at least some new methodologies, so we can sense, communicate, and localize better. And also, is with a technology that, with a methodology or a technology, if you will, and that you won't have to predefine the trajectories anymore, but you will have the AUVs cooperating, talking to each other, and talk by using only their sensor, but using only sensor measurement, fully autonomously decide where to go. So that's why it's an autonomous square thing that is part of the equipment we use. Those are the AUVs. This is a boat. This is a boat here that actually can be used as an automated surface boat. So you do not have people on that and automatically run. And this is the ROV. So it's like an AUV again, but it's bigger and it's operated through through a cable. That's actually the ROV where the Maria's vision system was plugged, because it was not possible to plug it in the AUV because they're too small. Basically the idea here is that to have the AUVs, I don't want to go into details, but stop, in areas where you have height differences, because those are probably the areas that carry crucial information, probably the barrel that you are looking for or something like that, or stop and autonomously look around, and in case that of areas where there is nothing to see, of little importance, they just walk quickly through these areas, because otherwise they will lose time. This is an experiment we have. I'm just showing the. This is the actual map we have. The three different colors and lines are the AUVs trajectories, and you can see that in areas where we have high intensity, differences in the height, the AUV stay, and of course in areas where this doesn't happen, the AUV move fast. And of course, the cooperation thing is that the AUVs try to not to map the same area that is already mapped by another AUV. Anyways, the whole thing is a global. The whole thing can be formulated as an adaptive optimization problem. It's an optimization because the AUVs try to optimize the accuracy of the map they have, of course, in as fast as they can. But it's also adaptive because, I mean, you have to learn. So because you don't know the area, and also you don't know the underwater dynamics. So the AUVs have some adaptive mechanisms embedded with them, so as to be able to learn or adapt, or I don't know what is the correct word. So this is an some results from an actual experiment we ran in the port of Porto. So this is map we got using only sonar measurements using the usual practice. That is what they do. Usually that's what the port of Porto together with the Portuguese army is doing to map the part of the Atlantic Ocean. So pretty fine trajectories again. You can see here the map they came up, and this is the map using the Nautilus AUVs. There we had two AUVs cooperating, and of course the map is you can see that it's way better. And actually we were able with two AUVs to achieve three times better accuracy at 10% of the time. That was way faster. We required way less sensor measurements, which is also important in this kind of stuff. Don't want to go into details, but just to say here that this was the trajectory of the usual practice, and that was something that our AUV did. Now, going to, of course, as I already said, that in order to be able for the AUVs to better map these areas and to better map and to have a better, to be able to deploy them in real life underwater missions, you have to have a better sensor, way better sensors than the existing ones. And that was one of, Maria's task was to develop, and she came up with the concept of seeing through murky waters. Before I go to explain how this works, although Stefan has already expressed some stuff way better than I can do, just to mention that usually the AUVs rely on sonars. That is, for those of you that don't know how sonars are, they use acoustic signals to get images. Many different disadvantages of sonars. The one is that they cannot see well when they come close to the target. So that's something that the regular camera does not have this problem. They don't carry ambient information because they are used on acoustic signals. And I think that this is the most important thing, is that they are disturbed by the acoustic communications. The AUV modems are also based on acoustic signals, so whenever one AUV sends a message to another AUV or to the sender, you have the sea shaking. So the sonar has to wait until the water is relaxed again in order to take a picture. Okay. The visual systems that do not have this problem, they don't interfere that much, at least with the acoustic model. But the existing, the conventional visual system can operate typically only under blue lagoon conditions. Okay, you have to have a very clear, sea, and that so the camera can work. Even there, sometimes you have problems. And that's where the Maria's concept came. So this is, okay, I will skip this. So basically, the idea is, Stefanos explained very well the idea, is to take the same, and Stefanos correct me if I'm wrong, okay, but the idea is to take the same photo using different lighting conditions. The challenge here is that if you do this in a laboratory, you can place your lights wherever you want, and you have plenty of time to process the results. When it comes to the real life application with the underwater application, you have two different problems. First of all, you cannot place the lights wherever you want. They have to be on the ROV or the AUV at the specific locations. So this is something that constrains a lot the application. And also you have to be real time. So you have to come up with the clear image very quickly. This is just an example of how the images that are taken in real life, and this is after the processing. I can show you a video. Some experiments that Akis had performed. So here you can see the actual image, and you can see here how this, the actual image is very, very blurry, and this is the outcome of the image processing algorithm. This is even way less visible, I think. And after the so the way they do it is by, if you have three or more lights, because they have four lines, you come up, as Stefan said, into four different equations, and you try to solve. I think that their main contribution was not only that they found the equations, which is probably easy to find, but also to simplify these equations, to throw away non-linearities that are probably only cause the problem there, they are not useful. And so they were able to come up with the algorithm that is fast and work in real time. So this is part of the experiments that they have done. This is the ROV, as I already told you. This is again the ROV, and this is an image they've taken. This is a barrel. I think that is like 10 meters on the sea floor, on the depth of about around 10 meters in the port of port, in a very, very dirty area, because it's a port. And you can see here what are the original images and the restored image after they came up with the, after they applied the algorithm. What is important is that this this thing here, which was used by an object recognition algorithm to understand that this is the barrel that I'm looking for. So that was about my presentation.